It is never, ever too late to buy low, especially on some players that people may not be believing in so much. So, Nate, let's get into it. These are guys that, you know, we might just be stashing for this year. These are guys that we might have a little bit more hope for this season. Either way, we're going to break it down for you. Nate, kick it off. I know you love going first.
I do. And I will preface this. See, I use preface correctly.
I do not use words correctly.
To preface this, I took this in a different way than Mike did. I went with some buy lows. Mike went with some buy lows. So you're going to see some difference between the players that we chose.
You know, sometimes you got to zig when other people zag, and that's okay. But look, I have
reasons. Options, baby. And this is a nice buy low if you're contending. You know, I'm looking for who can I buy for cheap that's going to help me win a championship. And one guy that will definitely help me do that is Chris Godwin. Chris Godwin, currently 105 overall in rankings on Keep Trade Cut, and wide receiver 41. 41, Mike. Way too good to be wide receiver 41. He's going back to the slot for the Bucs this year. Which is really important because last year he did not play in the slot a ton. Last year, only 37% in the slot. But in the four seasons before that, he was always around 70% in the slot. Chris Godwin is a slot wide receiver and a very good one at that. He can play outside, sure. He absolutely can. He looked still good last year, but he is much better in the slot. Mike Evans outside. In 2022, he saw 137 targets and caught 104 of them for a wide receiver 19 finish with only 3 touchdowns. It was, you know, it wasn't a very great scoring offense for Chris Godwin, but he was very, very productive still. Had more touchdowns last year and was still very productive. But last year was the first time since 2018. 2018, Mike, get ready for this stat. You have to listen to this stat. Last year in 2023 was the first time since 2018 that Chris Godwin was not a top 15 wide receiver in points per game.
And how far outside of that was he?
He was the wide receiver 34 in points per game with 12.3. But outside of that, has been very, very productive and very, very underrated that entire time. And now he's got a good quarterback. He's got Baker Mayfield. You know, maybe not the best quarterback in the whole league, but looked solid last year. Is there for a couple of years. Can definitely maintain both Mike Evans and Chris Godwin for fantasy football. And this is much of the same offense. There hasn't been a ton of change. You know, Dave Canales, he left for a head coaching job, so there's a new offensive coordinator there. But otherwise, this offense looks pretty much the same. Jalen McMillan comes in. He was drafted, day 2 pick. I don't think he's going to do too much. Not going to eat into Chris Godwin's target share very much, but he does open up flexibility for Chris Godwin because McMillan can play inside and outside as well, giving Godwin the ability to move outside if they need him to, stay on the field, you know, move in the slot if they need him to. So I think that's going to just help him. You know, they have a good wide receiver 3 that can take away, you know, be a threat to the defense and help Chris Godwin, Mike Evans out that much more. I'm expecting another top 24 season. I should be expecting a top 15 season by points per game, but not quite going that far. I do expect a wide receiver 2 season out of Chris Godwin, though. I think they're going to be pretty productive. And you can get him right now for a second round pick. Devin Singletary, Amari Cooper. You get a little bit younger and keep the same production, if not better. And then Jake Ferguson. I like Jake Ferguson a lot, but if you need a wide receiver and you got some tight end depth, I'd move him for Chris Godwin.
Let's move to Cincinnati, where I'm picking up a wide receiver, Andre, I believe it is pronounced Yoshivas. He is player 229 on Keep Trade Cut, wide receiver 84. He's the starting slot. Jamar Chase and T. Higgins are there. Yeah, they are. However, Nate, in the 3 years that the trio of Higgins, Chase, and Tyler Boyd were together, Tyler Boyd averaged 91 targets, 64 receptions, 752 yards, and 4 touchdowns. Keep in mind, Joe Burrow misses some time too, so a lot of this is with a backup quarterback. Jake Browning did acquit himself pretty well last year. I am not saying Yoshivas, Iosevis is what it looks like, is Tyler Boyd, but I'm saying the opportunity is there. Now, Patreon.com/DynastyRewind, getting that $5 or $10 tier if you want to see Bob's full projections, but he has him projected at 470 targets, 43 receptions, 427 yards, 5 touchdowns for 118 fantasy points and 6.98 fantasy points per game. I feel like that's probable, but we can't ignore the opportunity that he has the opportunity to possibly do more than that this year. And with T. Higgins likely leaving after this year, it could expand more next year too. So this is a stash where we're talking a guy who has potential wide receiver three upside coming in as a flex starter for injuries. You have other injured guys. You have a ton of bye weeks. You know, you always get screwed 1 week a year where all your team is on bye and the waiver wire just looks like absolute hot garbage. This could be a guy to pluck in there. And we're talking, you can get him for a third round pick. I've seen him traded straight up for Tyler Boyd, and occasionally in deeper leagues, he was a throw-in piece as well. So this isn't a guy who's going to break the bank for you, but he could definitely outperform his ADP. Nate, who is your next buy-low player? Although I like where your head's at here, I don't think he's going to be a buy-low for very long. That's the only thing I'm saying.
Exactly, and I do have a running back on here, just so everyone knows. I am talking about a running back at some point this week. I'm talking about Marshawn Lloyd, all 5'9", 220 pounds. Of him, I believe it's like 95th percentile in the BMI. Marshawn Lloyd is really good. This is a guy that I love coming out of college. And everything that I've heard from training camp has been that, you know, obviously very early on, he was pushing AJ Dillon for the job. AJ Dillon ended up on the IR, so AJ Dillon's out of the picture. Marshawn Lloyd there is the RB2. Now, I will say Emmanuel Wilson is probably the RB2 for the first week or two, because Marshawn Lloyd is coming off a slight hamstring injury. He did practice the last 2 days as of recording today, recording day Tuesday, September 3rd. He did not practice. He was on the bike, and some people were concerned. I looked into it, found out LaFleur said, hey, this was part of the process. We said 2 days of practice, then he gets a day off, so nothing to be concerned about. I don't think he's going to be very active the first week or two of the football season as they continue to bring him back from this, so Josh Jacobs will get plenty of the workload as expected. But moving forward into the rest of the season, Marshawn Lloyd is going to be a little bit of thorn in Jacobs' side. Now, Josh Jacobs is someone who had a lot of carries so far in his career. He's up to 1,305 carries in his career. He's also caught a lot of passes. I should have grabbed that too. That probably puts him around 1,500 touches so far in his career. And he did miss 4 games last year. So not only is there the opportunity for Marshawn Lloyd to be a decent RB2 and play in a good role with the Packers and an efficient offense, but also if Josh Jacobs misses any time, I do believe that Marshawn Lloyd could handle a fuller workload and be a productive piece for that Green Bay Packers offense. I think he fits very well into how explosive they are and how quickly they move. I think he's also pretty good in pass protection. So, you know, obviously that gets these guys on the field early. Marshawn Lloyd, once he's healthy by week 3 or 4, I think he's going to be out there pretty often for a backup running back. Josh Jacobs, of course, is the RB1 here. Lloyd's not taking that over this year. Maybe next year. This is something I talked about early on in the offseason, is that Josh Jacobs' contract, it was a 3-year deal, but they do have a pretty easy out after this year. It could very well be a 2-year deal. It's definitely not a 3-year deal, though, based on how they structured that thing. So we could see Josh Jacobs go after this year if it's not a great year. If he does have a good year, I would expect him to keep him another year. But either way, Marshawn Lloyd does have a path to relevance, not just, you know, as the backup for Jacobs because of his efficiency, but also if something happens to Jacob, whether injury or he leaves the team, Marshawn Lloyd seems like he's the next guy up at this point. So really excited about him. He's got a 4.46 speed, 93rd percentile speed score, which takes the into his size into account as well. Expectation-wise, I think he's like an RB4 this season. You know, as a backup, it's hard to do much better than that with the touches you're going to get. So RB4-ish on this season. But I think we're going to see some weekly flashes of top 24 production. You give Marshawn Lloyd 15 touches in the game, and I think he's going to give you top 24 production because he's a really good pass catcher. He's explosive. He creates a lot of big plays. Big fan of just his ability to create. You know, I love running backs that can create something. NFL teams love that as well. So Marshawn Lloyd, accessible because for some reason, well, I know the reason, he got injured, but it was a small injury. He dropped from RB30 to RB40 on keep trade cut. Right now he's back up to RB37, but not quite up to the value where he was just a month ago. So good buy low right before the season. You can get it for Adonai Mitchell, Aaron Jones, Jalen Wright, Sam Howell, Chuba Hubbard, to name a couple players I would move for Marshawn Lloyd. And then I saw a trade with Ray Davis for Marshawn Lloyd. I like Ray Davis, but I like Marshawn Lloyd more.
Yeah, I agree. And I think right now, Marshawn Lloyd's long-term viability is much clearer than that of Ray Davis. Chuba Hubbard, Aaron Jones, probably going to have better seasons this year than Marshawn Lloyd will. But again, long-term, I like this. And I think it's a great play. Let's talk about New York Jets running back Braylon Allen, 159 on keep trade cut. He's running back 42. This is also the youngest player in the 2024 draft class. He graduated high school at 17, went up to Wisconsin. Breece Hall is only signed through 2025. Okay, so there is a possibility. Actually, it's not just a possibility. It's something that the Jets do where they suck every year. Maybe they tank a little bit and they don't re-sign Breece Hall. It's possible, because if you need more than just a running back, why would you spend a ton of money on Breece Hall? Let him go. Let him get his bag. You have a cost-controlled young running back right here. If you don't think it could happen where he could get Breece Hall could get traded, it happened to Christian McCaffrey. So stranger things out there have happened. He's a strong runner, sitting a year. Learning can help him all facets of the game. My expectations for him this year are absolutely none, unless Breece Hall misses a week. This is a guy more of a stash for me than anything else. But if Breece Hall goes down, twists his ankle up a little bit, Braylon Allen is the next guy up. What does he cost? Really glad you asked. In a Superflex league, I drafted him into 312 a couple weeks ago. So, you know, normally I wouldn't take guys like this, but I'm trying to expand my dynasty and fantasy portfolio, saying, hey, at the 312, we're almost in the fourth round. Let me take a guy who might not just had to hang out for a year. I saw him going also for 25 third, and again, a throw-in in a lot of trades as well. So you're getting him cheap. He's kind of an afterthought, but could pay off very good dividends in the long run. Nate, for the record, you put names on the sheet before me. This was one that I was thinking about.
There we go. See, I didn't fill out the sheet before you, but I did put my names on there before you.
You claimed it. I claimed it. It's like Colin Shock.
Yeah, I just don't – I honestly just don't get it with this player. I don't understand why everyone stopped caring. Why did everyone stop caring about DeAndre Hopkins, literally one of the best wide receivers that we have seen in this generation? I don't know. All right, so how many times do you think he finished as a top five wide receiver in points per game?
Top five? I'm going to go – you know what? Let's go five times.
Five times.
Oh, is it really?
Five times. Okay. Yep. Cool. 2015, 2017, 2018, 2019, and 2020, all – top five. That stretch from 2017 to 2020, 4 years in a row, he was number two, number three, number four, and then number five. And then in 2021, he averaged 14.7 points per game. It doesn't list a number on Player Profiler for what finish that would have been, but I'm assuming that probably still would have been pretty good. Probably like top 20. 14.7 is pretty solid. And then in 2022, he finished with 16.9 points per game. He only played in 9 games. Remember, he was suspended. But that was good enough for wide receiver 9 in points per game in just 9 games. And then last year, he played all 17 games. So if you're worried about his age, he played all 17 games. In fact, DeAndre Hopkins over his career outside of suspension really hasn't missed many games. He has not been injured very often. But last year, playing all 17 games, he did finish as the wide receiver 29 with 13.2 points per game. And that was on a pretty horrid Titans offense, Mike, where Ryan Tannehill was there. Rookie Will Levis was there. I think there might have been somebody else in there at some point who I'm probably pretty glad I don't remember the name of. But this is still one of the best wide receivers in the league. Finished as the wide receiver 22 overall last year. We got to give this man his flowers. I don't care if he is 32 years old. This is a future Hall of Famer. He's probably going to be good for another 2 years. DeAndre Hopkins. Let's just look at some of the stats from last year, because that's where we go off. We go off the last year, right? He was 31 and a half years old last year. So let's see what he did. Saw 136 targets, Mike, on a putrid offense, like I said, which was good for 14th in the NFL. With those targets, he had 1,905 air yards. Now, air yards basically are just, don't worry if you complete the pass or not, how many yards came of the pass. So, you know, if I throw to a guy 40 yards down the field, that's 40 air yards. Doesn't matter if he catches it or not. It kind of takes into account their, you know, depth of target, how many targets they're getting, you know, how valuable are those targets. Air yards takes all that into account and just kind of gives you the overall raw number of air yards. So second in the NFL last year, Will Levis was throwing those bombs to DeAndre Hopkins. And we're going to see more of that this year. So second last year in air yards, fifth in the NFL last year with air yard share with 41.6%. So nearly half of the team's air yards were going towards DeAndre Hopkins. 35 deep targets last year, good for second in the league. And Mike, this is the opportunity for him to improve upon last year. Second in the NFL with 1,071 unrealized air yards. So plays where it was an incomplete pass for one reason or another, but all those deep targets, he was getting the opportunities down the field. And this is a guy that continues to win contested catches, continues to get open, continues to just create yards after the catch as well and score touchdowns. So this guy's still really good. 28.6 target share last year, good for 12th. That's elite. Anything over 25% is really good. He's still got that target hog ability. And Calvin Ridley getting out of there is not really going to worry me. Number one, Calvin Ridley didn't do too much last year with the Jaguars until Christian Kirk got hurt. Also, Calvin Ridley, I've just never been a big believer, and there's not like a strong tight end or wide receiver three that's going to steal targets. Calvin Ridley can get plenty of targets on his own and still be many, 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 many more targets available for DeAndre Hopkins from Will Levis. 42% dominator rating last year, also second among wide receivers. So that offense ran through DeAndre Hopkins last year. I expect to see some more of the similar this year. I think he's going to have a top 24 season again. He could be outside of that if Will Levis is just terrible. You know, this does kind of, you know, rely on Will Levis being at least serviceable. But as long as Will Levis is serviceable, DeAndre Hopkins, he has been quarterback proof his entire career. Mike, I couldn't even put together the list of quarterbacks he played with in Houston before before Deshaun Watson got there, because it would bring up too many bad memories for too many people hearing some of those names that played quarterback for the Texans. So I'm not worried too much about what Will Levis is going to do this year, because I think Hopkins is going to be fine on his own. And at wide receiver 66 on Keep Trade Cut, it's just too cheap if you're a contending team to not go out there and get DeAndre Hopkins for your team if you need some wide receiver depth. You can get him for Jacoby Myers, Rashid Shaheed, Jerry Jeudy. I saw someone, multiple times I saw someone trade him away for 2/3. I would love to give somebody 2/3 and lock down a guy I can put in my starting lineup every year. Now, if you want to move a second round pick for DeAndre Hopkins, which you probably can pick him up from another team if you trade a second. I don't know if I'd recommend that, though. As much as you can make that happen, if you want to move a second round pick for a wide receiver, I would recommend someone probably better for Dynasty, because at the end of the day, DeAndre Hopkins is 32 years old. For a second round pick, I think you can go get Chris Godwin, Christian Kirk, Terry McLaurin, Deontay Johnson. I think those guys are better Dynasty long-term pickups than DeAndre Hopkins for a second-round pick. But any other cheaper pick, go out there and get yourself some DeAndre Hopkins before it's too late and you don't have him anymore. Appreciate him while he's still here.
All right, so you're talking about the wide receiver 66. How about the wide receiver 81 on Keep Trade Cut? That is New York Giants wide receiver Jalin Hyatt. He's 222 overall, and like I said, wide receiver 81. Look, we're stashing here, right? I feel Hyatt can only go up from here. 23 catches, 373 yards, and 0 touchdowns. He was 98, wide receiver 98 last year, 3.5 fantasy points per game. However, in week 12, he showed that he can do it. 5 catches and 109 yards. Talent's there. Okay, we're not going to argue that he is a talented wide receiver. A lot of people are like, oh, the Tennessee scheme. Well, fine. But look, the fact of the matter is, this is a guy who can go out there and do it. Like I said, week 12, 5 catches, 109 yards. And hey, I hate to say this, but Daniel Jones has shown he could be capable when healthy. Okay, in 2022, under head coach Brian Daboll, he went 9-6-1, and he had 317 completions out of 472 attempts, 3,205 yards, 15 touchdowns, and only 5 interceptions. Had a lot of rushing yards as well, too. But because we're talking about Jalin Hyatt, focusing more on his passing yards, Jalin Hyatt was 8th overall in yards per reception last year with 16.2. That's impressive. Adding Malik Nabers, losing Saquon Barkley might help him. Another receiver to take coverage off. They might have to run more if they don't trust Devin Singletary enough. Devin Singletary is still a buy for me. So maybe the New York Giants, like I said, they don't run as much as they used to. They got him. They got Tyrone Tracy, who's a glorified special teamer. They got Eric Gray there as well. So I think he's going to max out at a low-end wide receiver at best this year. But again, this is a long-term play, and either he blossoms and get more targets, or the Giants upgrade a quarterback, or there's a potential for both. I saw he was going for a late third or a fourth round pick in some cases. And again, he's a throw in a lot of cases. Yeah. Nobody wants Jalin Hyatt. One man's trash is another. Yeah. And that's fine. Cause you know, if he does anything is better than nothing. So would you like,
he's a good throw in?
Yeah. He's a good throw in. Would you like another almost free ad?
Yeah. Why not?
Washington Commanders wide receiver, Noah Brown. He's new to the Commanders, but not new to Dan Quinn. He was with the Cowboys when Dan Quinn was their defensive coordinator for a couple of years, so they were in the same building together. He's currently listed at the starter as the starter over Diami Brown, Diami, whatever. Wide receiver 67 in 2023. Okay, did miss some time. I'll get to that in a second. 33 catches, 567 yards, and 2 touchdowns in a really nice and somewhat loaded Houston Texans wide receiver room there. But he was fourth in yards per reception with 17.2, despite missing seven games with various injuries, Nate. Groin strain. No thanks. I'll pass on that one. A knee contusion and back soreness. He's got some upside opposite Terry McLaurin. Got a rookie quarterback in Jane Daniels, who we know can sling it. And he's going for fourth round draft picks, Nate. Fourth round draft picks. And I bet there's some leagues out there where he might just be hanging out on the waiver wire.
I was going to say, I bet he's on the waiver wire in a good many leagues.
Yeah, I'm sure he is. A little more shallow leagues, but there's some guys that you could probably bump off your roster that aren't going to do anything for Noah Brown. Nate, I think that's all we got for today. Enjoy the NFL. Set some lineups. You know what? The best thing to do to celebrate the football season is go buy yourself a Dynasty Rewind t-shirt. Link is below. Free week on Patreon. Patreon.com/DynastyRewind. Until next time, everybody. For Nate, I'm Mike. Thanks for listening.